Good afternoon, and thank you for having me in this fantastic event. My talk is a little bit different from what we have been hearing here. It's about drugs, or better still, about drugs policy. Where Portugal is, I think, we are the face of Europe towards America. We are very close to Morocco, and we are one of the gates for drugs to come to the European market. So we are quite exposed to it. We are roughly 10 million inhabitants, quite stable. And the story I want to tell you is, as you probably know, Portugal lived for a long time, for almost 50 years, with a dictatorship, Salazar, maybe sounds to you. And during that time, we had no problems with drugs. A closed society, very controlled by censorship, by the political police, and no one dared to use drugs. They were not available at all. We're a very isolated country with very limited mobility. It was almost impossible to travel abroad. We were neither very sexy destination for tourism. So we lived there completely isolated. And some movements that happened elsewhere, such as the hippie movement or the students' movement in France, didn't touch us. But during the last years of the regime, we were dealing with a colonial war, our ancient colonies, you know, Angola, Mozambique, Cape Verde, Guinea-Bissau, and so on. And almost all our young male population was sent there to serve as soldiers. And down there, drug use was tolerated or even incentivized to keep people happy with that war. In 1974, we had our democratic revolution, the Carnation Revolution. And shortly after, we had the end of the colonial war, the return of the soldiers and settlers to mainland, almost a million people coming back to mainland. And as you may imagine, the impact of such a big amount of people coming back was huge in our society. And they came back with their habits and bringing cannabis that suddenly was made available for everybody. So, and there was a kind of an explosion on experimentation. Shortly after, some criminal organizations bringing all the other substances and making them available. And unlike what happened with other countries where people could learn how to deal with drugs, we had no time for that. Suddenly everything was available. Cannabis, lots of them, plenty of cannabis everywhere, but also cocaine, heroin, LSD, you name it. And we were completely naive about drugs. So it was easy to shift from one to another without even understanding that we were doing different substances. So problems related to drugs developed very fast. And what is particularly important, in my view, is that it was cross-cutting all the layers of society, not only the most disadvantaged people, marginalized people, but medium class, upper classes, political class, everybody. In just a matter of a decade, it was almost impossible to find a Portuguese family that had no problems related to drugs. So it became an important social and political issue in our society. By the end of the 20th century, we estimate, we don't have accurate surveys from that time, but we estimate that we could have 100,000 people hooked on heroin, which is 1% of our society, 1% of our population. So you may imagine the impact that it had in our population. While in other countries we could always see a line for the total prevalence and a much lower line for problematic drug use, in Portugal, what happened, it was a very small gap between those two lines, almost as if everybody who was experimenting became addicted and problematic user. So by 98, the state started to build some responses to deal with the problem, but we needed to have a clear strategy to deal with those problems. By 98, cannabis was by far the most used substance, as it still is. I must say that social use, recreational use of cannabis is being discussed right now, in this moment, at the parliament in Portugal. But it was not the case. But the most problematic was heroin, by far. Heroin and cocaine, LSD, ecstasy, and so on. The big effects, the big problems arising from that drug use came from sharing of injecting material. HIV had come along shortly before this to complicate things. We had a huge number of overdoses deaths, at least one overdoses death a day. That means 360 something every year. Small criminality, we never had a big violent criminality related to drugs, but the petty crimes, acquisitive crimes to maintain the drug use were very present and caused a huge burden in the society. So let's come to this again. 1% of our population, 100,000 problematic drug users across all social groups. This is the kind of the scene that you could see in all our cities. We have the biggest supermarket of drugs in Europe, the so-called Casal Ventoso, where almost 5,000 people a day used to come to buy and to use drugs. In 1999, the responses took form. A new strategy in 1999 was approved. A new paradigm, which I'll talk later, a national coordination, a national network of intervention structures, and a new intervention model. About the first Portuguese strategy on drugs, it was our prime minister at the time was António Guterres, who is now the Secretary General of the United Nations, and he noticed, he was very concerned about the issue, and he invited a group of experts from several areas, from judges to psychiatrists, doctors, psychologists, 9 people, among whom I was included, and he asked her to propose a strategy to address the problems, which we did. The only boundary that the Prime Minister put to us was that we should keep within the spirit of the treaties of the United Nations, which is to keep the prohibitionist paradigm. And we proposed a strategy with a focus on the supply reduction for the police authorities and customs, but mostly on the demand reduction and based in humanism and pragmatism. The proposal included a network for treatment, preventive responses, social reintegration, harm reduction policies, harm reduction meaning that even if someone is still using drugs, even cannot stop using drugs, even if someone does not want to stop using drugs, he or she still deserves the investment of the state in order to have a better life and a longer life. So decriminalization came on top of this to introduce coherence on all this system. And evaluation. From the beginning, we started to evaluate to understand what was going to happen, because it was the first country to decriminalize drug use. That strategy was approved by the government, but the issue of the decriminalization is not within the powers of the government, so it had to be discussed at the parliament. which happened 1 year later. That's why the decriminalization law came only in 2000. But it's important to think that the decriminalization of drug use is only one of the measures. It is not the silver bullet for it. It's important because it turns the mindset of people. It gives to people who use drugs, who suffer from drug use, who get addicted, the same dignity as sick people, as patients, that people who suffer from other kind of diseases. And this is very, very important, and that makes all the difference. So, decriminalization was introduced in the we only changed one article of the previous drugs law. That was a law from 93, quite tough law. It still remains. We only changed one article, which is the one who deals with personal use and possession for personal use. Okay. And there's a limit, there's a boundary. And in my view, this is also very important. That boundary, the threshold for criminal procedures, stands on personal use for 10 days. If you are intercepted by the police in a public place using drugs or in possession of drugs, if you have more than the quantity for 10 days, you undergo criminal procedure as before. But if you have less, you must only present to a commission for dissuasion of drug addiction, which is a body within or under the Ministry of Health. So once you go there, you are evaluated by professionals, by psychologists, social workers, and so on, trying to assess what kind of needs do you have? What kind of user are you? Are you a problematic one? Are you addicted, in need of treatment? Do you need any kind of help? Or even if you are not addicted, what kind of lifestyle do you have? How is your family? How is your environment? How are you dealing with some difficulties that everyone has in life, in adolescence or later? So the aim is to identify as precociously as possible any problem that the citizen may have and address him to the adequate responses in society. It's important to say that drug use in Portugal is still prohibited, so this kept us within that spirit of those United Nations treaties. Those commissions are not drug courts. There are some countries that have installed drug courts with lighter procedures than the usual courts, but they are still under the Ministry of Health. So, well, it only works if you have a good coordination with other services, of course. And, well, there are a long list of sanctions that are possible, administrative sanctions that those dissuasion commissions may apply. It's important to say that for addicted people, never a monetary fee. And just to show you some data, since those commissions were installed in 2001, they dealt with 121,000 different persons, 64,000 of them were assessed as non-problematic, but even then 19,000 were addressed to other social responses, and from the problematic users, 10,000 were invited to join a treatment facility, and 8,700 actually initiated treatment. Well, the United Nations were very critical at the beginning. They started to put pressure on our government, but in 2009, for the first time, they said, well, the Portuguese model falls within the spirit of the United Nations. And in 2016, at the UNGAS, the special session of the United Nations Assembly on drugs, we had an event where the president of the INCB said that the Portuguese approach is a model of best practices within the spirit of the United Nations. So we were a kind of snowbreakers or icebreakers to that kind of intervention of the United Nations. Only to tell you that we have a national coordinator quite effective that involves 11 ministries. So we try to develop responses in all governmental areas. We have an integrated policy that stands on those pillars, that acts in all those contexts: community, family, school, recreation, labor, driving, prison, sport. And that leads to some results that I'll show you very briefly. This is the evolution of injecting drug use. The bottom line, the yellow one, is the new people seeking for treatment. You can see that in 2010 we had 11% of people were using by injection, and nowadays we have only 3%. The red line are those of relapsed, and that an increase during our financial crisis that had a huge impact, a huge social impact. And this is, for me, this is the most impressive graph. This is the evolution of HIV infection. The orange line, no, the red line is from drug users, infection by HIV among drug users. The orange is on heterosexuals. The blue line is on homo bisexuals. And as you can see, it was a huge increase of infections among drug users, and then it dropped. And in those three contingents, this is the lowest contribution for new infections nowadays. This is the evolution of the distribution of syringes and needles, and this is the evolution of methadone programs. Okay, so those are the key responses to offer to this. Overdoses deaths, in red, you can see we have one of the lowest rates of overdoses deaths across the European Union nowadays. In 2017, we had 38 overdoses deaths. That means very, very, very few. This is the evolution of people seeking for treatment. What is the main drug that they are using? In red is heroin, is dropping, as you can see. In yellow, it's cocaine, quite stable. And what is increasing nowadays is cannabis. People seeking treatment for cannabis use. Well, just skip this and to end my presentation, I'm sorry. What we can notice from 2001, a small increase in reported illicit drug among adults, but a reduction of drug use among adolescents since 2003, a reduced burden of drug offenders on the criminal justice system, reduction in the prevalence of injecting drug use, reduction in opiate-related deaths and infectious diseases, reduced stigma of drug users. This is very, very important. Increase in the amounts of drugs seized by the authorities. This is a curious side effect, because police does not have to deal with the users on the street. They can address bulk traffic, and instead of seizing grams or kilos, they seize tons in open sea, in containers, and a reduction in the public burden caused by drugs. And to finish with some ideas I want to share with you. There is a scientific consensus that criminal sanctions are ineffective and counterproductive. They do nothing to address drug use consequences. On the other side, nowhere the United Nations treaties impose criminal procedures for drug users. What we advocate is health protection and respect for human rights instead of punishment. Drug policies should be based on health and not on punishment, and this is a challenge for the future. Thank you.